Today we're going to be talking about William and Ellen Craft, who are a couple who were enslaved here in Macon, Georgia. They wrote a narrative in 1860. It was published entitled Running 1,000 Miles to Freedom. And we're standing in front of the home in which Ellen Craft, in fact, lived while she was a slave. On the plantation is where they met. They were united because William's owner had taken out a loan, and he didn't have the money, and so he mortgaged his slaves in order to get the money. When the bill came due, he couldn't pay it. So the slaves were sold by a bank, and the same owner that had bought Ellen, in fact, bought William. And so they ended up on the plantation, you know, together. They were married on the plantation, but they knew that, and Ellen said, she did not want to have children while she was a slave because she knew what would happen to those kids, and she simply couldn't take it. So we get this really picture, this portrait of Ellen and also William, who was very supportive of her. As a couple who were in love, they wanted a normal life. They wanted the same kind of life that you and I have, for example. But they were denied that because of the laws of slavery. That generated this incessant desire, unquenchable thirst to leave and to get out of the state of Georgia, and in fact, to leave the South so that they could actually have a life. In 1848, they decided that they were going to leave. They planned the trip for 4 days, they took off at night. They left and they went to Savannah, and from Savannah, they caught a ship, sailed to Charleston, North Carolina, and then made some stops along the way, Wilmington, North Carolina, et cetera, and then they finally ended up in Philadelphia. But then once in Philadelphia, the abolitionists there told them that they really wouldn't be as safe in Philadelphia as they would be in Boston, Massachusetts, because the laws in Philadelphia were different than they were in Massachusetts. And so they helped them get to Boston, where there was a free black society of about 200 or 300 free blacks, you know, there, who had been there really for really quite some time. And they helped them get themselves together. They helped with health issues as well. Ellen had gotten sick. And so they kind of built them up. And then they slipped them out of the country when they found out that their owners, after the passage of the Fugitive Slave Act, had sent this patrol out to try to return them to slavery. And it's very interesting because the President of the United States, Millard Fillmore, was contacted and appealed to by their owners, their previous owners, to bring them back. And he, in fact, agreed that they should return to Georgia. And he, in fact, sent a military patrol after them. And so they knew they had to leave. And so the Vigilant Society helped them escape. They went to Maine, and they caught a ship, and they went to England. Ellen was extremely light-skinned. She could have passed for white. They used that as an advantage. And so Ellen masqueraded as an indigent white man to go on the journey. She even pretended that she had rheumatism and something was wrong with her right arm. So they made a sling for her right arm. She cut her hair. Her husband, in fact, cut her hair. He bought her a pair of green glasses, glasses that were shaded green. And then they took a big handkerchief, like a scarf, and tied it from her chin to the top of her head, you know, and around, that hid part of her face so it would not show that she didn't have a beard or any kind of facial hair. She pretended also to be deaf at times so that she wouldn't speak and give away the fact that she was a woman and, in fact, not a man. This was also very important because they knew that they were going to have to register at hotels and establishments along the way because they were intending to leave Georgia and get to Philadelphia, where there were the Friends Society, the Quakers, big abolitionist movement, and they knew that they would be safe there. But they knew along the way that they were going to have to make certain stops, and they would have to register. And she would be the one that would register because he was pretending to be her attendant, her servant, her slave. So by feigning this disguise, first she appeared as an indigent white man, and he actually got away with it. And he actually got away with being called her, you know, her slave. So that was very important, yeah, to do. It's a time when they were in Northern City, near Halifax, where they were went to a hotel, and here is where Northern anti-black sentiments, you know, kicked in, because they were going to check into a hotel, and the proprietor said, you can't check in here. He looked at William and said, you can't check in here. We don't allow black people in here, but she can, you know, your master, you know, can. And so William didn't fight it, you know. He said, well, okay, then she gets the room and I'll go somewhere else. So she checked in. The room was upstairs. When she checked in, of course, the attendants start coming, people who work there and all of that. And she ordered dinner. But she ordered dinner for two instead of one. And the hotel staff, including the black people who worked in the hotel, had a conversation wondering who was going to show up to have dinner with her, because it clearly couldn't have been this black guy, because this black guy was a slave. And then they were even more amazed when dinner time came and he walked up the stairs, and instead of knocking on the door and allowing and asking, you know, for her to allow him to come in, he just opened the door and walked in. And they were just dumbfounded as to, you know, what was going on, because they were just convinced that she was not only a white person, but she was a owner of this black guy. And by that time, she had discarded her male clothing, and she appeared as, in fact, the woman that she was. This was very interesting, because in the South, she could not have done that without raising a critical eye, because white women did not travel with black male servants in the 1840s and 1850s. That's just almost unheard of. So she really had to put on a good act, you might say. And in the narrative, you get this real sense sometimes where, and they both collaborated on the narrative, but William has a dominant voice in the text. You really get the sense of sometimes that he's laughing at the slave system and laughing at those they fooled. Well, the impact was great. The single thought on the mind of slaves was to escape, and to not just escape and go to South Carolina or someplace, but I mean escape and get out of the South, and never to go back. Most slaves that escaped went to Canada, because Canada had never participated in the slave trade, and once across the border, one was in fact safe, and the Fugitive Slave Act did not apply, you know, at that point. But the crafts not only escaped, but they did so in such a compelling way that they fooled the slave institution, you know? And it was, so it's not only that they escaped, but it also demonstrated their cunning, their intellect, their ingenuity, and their mastery over the slave institution. And so this story was just very, extremely compelling. And then when they went to England, to London, and became celebrities, literally, you know, in London, their story just, you know, spread like wildfire. So stories of escaped slaves were very, very important. It encouraged other slaves, first of all, to know that there was hope. So you get this real sense of adventure, of intrigue, and cunning, you know, et cetera. So this is why this story was so compelling.